You're listening to our podcast of Nick Ferrari at Breakfast on LBC. This is LBC from Global. Leading Britain's conversation with Nick Ferrari at Breakfast.
Well, it's 3 minutes after seven on Wednesday, August the 11th. That deportation flight did take off in the early hours of this morning. That more than two-thirds of the roughly 50 foreign criminals who were due to be deported were offloaded. We'll give you full details on that story. Other potential, I hope you heard that word, criminal matters. Prince Andrew could face a second lawsuit. This is another alleged victim. This time another young woman, Joanna Schoberg, bringing her allegations forward. We'll give you details on that as well. A-levels stand, it would appear, now in the dock. They possibly have no value, but just remember the young people who got those grades last night, and others, of course, others take their A-levels. Let's just celebrate what they achieved, although there does seem to be now a drive to get an alternative. What might that be? If we talk about driving, what about trying to drive across London and all transport matters? Well, the TfL Commissioner, Andy Byford, the man in charge of all travel in London, is with me later this morning. Last appeared on the show in March.
There's a lot of people now are working from home. Do we need all these trains? Do we need Crossrail? Do we need everything?
I think we do. I mean, there's a lot of doom and gloom merchants out there, Nick, who say that London's done. I don't believe that.
Lionel Messi picking up the best part of £1 million a week as he goes to Paris Saint-Germain. He was sobbing his eyes out a couple of days ago, wasn't he, as he left Barcelona. Amazingly, now he's got a smile back on his face, but if you trouser that much dough, it's hardly surprising if you think about it. And can you believe it? Boris's Blue Army is seeing red over the PM's drive to go green. Stay with me. And they might even change the idea of the red arrows. Really, I think we all know what an aircraft sounds like. But guess what? The vapour, whatever that comes out of the back, no longer red, white and blue. Honestly, they want to turn it green.
Nick Ferrari at Breakfast. Call 0345 6060 973. Text 84850. Nick Ferrari at Breakfast on LBC.
How can I prove to you that was a red arrow? It could have been a typhoon, it could have been anything, a MiG, I don't know many aircraft, it could have been anything. But that's can you believe this drive now to go green? The red arrows, they're not going to change the name, but the vapour that comes out the back of it would be green. The whole idea, isn't it, to celebrate the colours of the Union flag? That's later in the show. So that deportation went ahead despite considerable objection and rows, but a lot of the foreign criminals were not on board. LBC's political editor Theo Usherwood explains. Theo.
The flight took off at 1 a.m. from Britain, destined for Jamaica. There were due to be up to 50 convicted criminals on board, among them some who had served jail sentences for the most serious crimes, including murder and rape. The only problem for the Home Office is the majority of those who were due to be on that flight had been removed at the last minute following legal challenges. Home Secretary Priti Patel has, of course, talked tough in the past. This is what she said in March.
I have a message to those who seek to disrupt our enforcement officers. They should think about whether their actions may be preventing murderers, rapists, high-harm offenders from being removed from our communities. And they should think long and hard about the victims of these crimes.
The other problem for the Home Office is that campaigners think that this feels very much like the hostile environment adopted under Theresa May's leadership, which of course precipitated the Windrush scandal. That's because many of those deported have been in this country since they were very small children. Sarah Pownall is a former chief immigration officer.
Somebody has been here all their lives. Why don't they have British citizenship? Why has that not been applied for? They would certainly have indefinite leave to remain, I would imagine. And this is all sort of coming under the hostile environment policy. What happens is you end up with if people have applied for British citizenship and then they end up having their citizenship revoked. It's almost like a two-tier British citizenship.
This is, of course, not the first time the Home Secretary has failed to deport a number of convicted criminals. It happened last year, prompting calls from Priti Patel to toughen up the system. But Maurice McLeod from Race on the Agenda says these deportations feel very much like they are politically motivated.
I think they're quite performative. I think that what's going on here is a government that's trying to look tough and play to a particular audience. And so you pick the sort of easiest targets, and someone that you can call a criminal, someone that has committed a crime here, is going to have the least sympathy among the public. So it's easiest to sort of throw them out and be seen to be being tough on criminals and immigration.
That's Maurice McLeod from Race on the Agenda campaign, concluding Theo Usherwood's report. This idea that it is a, if you will, a second Windrush. Really? I don't know that I can subscribe to that, but what say you? A couple of experts to prompt our conversation. First up, Bella Sankey, who's Director of Detention Action. In a sentence, Bella Sankey, can I ask you to explain what Detention Action does to my listeners? Good morning.
Good morning, Nick. We support people in immigration detention. People can end up there for all sorts of reasons. And we're campaigning for a fundamental reform to our detention and deportation system.
Your view of what, thank you for that, your view of what took place around 1 a.m.
It was utter chaos last night, Nick. I was taking referrals from people at 9 o'clock at night, including one man who says his father was a British citizen, has a British passport, was a Windrush settler, who was being carried onto the plane because he's too unwell to walk.
What is his
too
crime?
Elderly
what,
and frail.
What was he found guilty of?
I don't know the details of his offence. I don't know anything about his case because, as I say, the referral came through incredibly late at night and we were undertaking urgent action to try and investigate the Windrush aspect, because obviously if he is Windrush entitled, then he's as good as a British citizen and shouldn't be being deported. So I think that's where the Windrush concerns come from, Nick.
I appreciate the efforts that you and your colleagues put in, but why would they have left that until around 9 p.m?
Because the Home Office doesn't know what it's doing, to be completely blunt.
No, but this gentleman does. This gentleman does. Let's call him Mr. A. Why would Mr. A and his team wait until 9 p.m. to contact you and your colleagues when you're staring down the gun 4 hours from deportation?
So what happens in these cases, Nick, is that the system often becomes completely overwhelmed. On this occasion, I don't think that his existing legal representatives knew what they were doing, and they didn't put in representations about his Windrush situation. He was also a very confused man. He's clearly suffering from mental health problems and was struggling to understand what's been going on with him the last couple of days.
And was he subsequently deported? Has he gone?
He has gone. The other thing that we saw happen last night were some absolutely horrifying suicide attempts by people who have been in the UK since they were young children. Two men are currently in hospital, and I believe that one of them is not conscious. He's got all of his family here. He said he would rather die in Britain than be returned to a country where he fears for his life. He was attacked and almost killed when he was 9 years old in Jamaica. That's why he was sent here, because of issues his family were having. He has, I believe, a assault conviction from when he was 14 years old.
Right.
From 2014.
My apologies. Do you honestly see this as another Windrush, Bella? Because in the terms of Windrush was a scar that will forever be on the preceding government, one has to say. But people caught up in that were utterly blameless here. And I appreciate it. Some instances, low level crime. They are all criminals.
So I think the thing with Windrush, Nick, is this is a legacy Windrush issue. The vast majority of the people that were on this flight or meant to be on the flight are only in the UK because of the legacy of Windrush, because their grandparents or their aunts or their uncles came to the UK. The reason why we have a big Jamaican community in the UK is because of the legacy of empire, yes, colonialism, slavery, and then Windrush. And so what you're doing by removing people's loved ones is you're re-inflicting the pain and trauma of a lot of those historical
events. Some of these emerge.
So here's the thing, Nick. I don't take issue with the use of deportation as a tool. I believe that sometimes it is going to be just and right and appropriate to deport an individual that's committed a very serious offence and doesn't have proper ties to the UK. But once someone has spent 20, 30 plus, 40 plus years in some of the cases we saw last night and has all of their family here, has young children here, then they are as good as British. And this is where you get into difficulties, because those individuals need a much more nuanced approach to their situation than the law allows. At the moment, the law says if you get a 12-month conviction, that's it, you're gone. So that scoops up in its path someone who's a serial murderer, but also somebody that's got a conviction for cannabis possession.
Bella, thank you for your time. Only for time reasons, I'll leave it there. I sense we'll talk again. Thank you for your valuable input, Bella Sankey, your Director of Detention Actions, making the point that it is a Windrush legacy issue. Do you agree? 13 after 7. Let's put that directly to Ben Harris-Quinney, who's chairman of the Bow Group. That's a centre-right think tank group. And Ben also is featured often in the pages of the Daily Express. It's a Windrush legacy issue. Ben, your view. Morning.
Good morning. Well, I don't think it can be described as a Windrush issue, because we have to remember that Windrush was about, really the scandal was about lost landing card for people that had come here legitimately and weren't criminals and were being deported because of a mix-up at the Home Office. This is about people that have committed very serious crimes. I mean, what we heard earlier, you don't get a 12-month sentence. Very rare that you get a 12-month sentence for cannabis possession. These are serious crimes, murders, serious assaults, rapes. And I think we have to remember that British citizenship or the right to be in this country is a privilege. And if people come here and commit very serious crimes, then I think they erode that privilege. And it's right that action is taken.
But let's use example, a young man born in Jamaica, comes here age 4 or 5, then goes on to commit that level of crime, whether it be arms, drugs, murder, whatever. Born in Jamaica, bred in the UK, surely it's our responsibility to look after him after his term?
No, I don't think so. I think
so. He came here at five.
It doesn't matter, because, as I say, the what's happened is a very serious crime has been committed, and we have to maintain the position that citizenship and residence in this country is a privilege, and it's not a privilege for those that come here and abuse our systems and kill people and commit serious crime. So I don't think you can say, well, yes, but he's been here since he was a child. The same rule must apply for everyone. And I think the message is that if you commit serious crime, there are serious consequences,
even though you may be going back to a country where you have effectively no network, no support network.
Look, people that commit serious crime go to prisons. Aren't nice places, but that's the punishment for the crime. And where I do think there is a point here is I think a lot of these cases are being used by the Home Office and used by Priti Patel to paper over the sheer scale of immigration, because the real public concern about immigration is in relation to mass immigration and is in relation to people that have come here in such huge numbers. 715,000 last year entered the country. So I do think we have to keep this in perspective, that we're talking...
Grateful to you, Ben. I must leave it there for time reasons. Ben Harris-Quinney, you chair the Bow Group think tank and you're a writer for the Daily Express. OK, it's another Windrush, or it's a Windrush legacy. I can't see that myself, but more importantly, what say you? Do give me a call on that number. Don't know what it is. Also coming up after the news, grim discovery in the Pyrenees.
The dead body of British hiker Esther Dingley has been found in the French Pyrenees by her own boyfriend. I'm Peter Allen, reporting for LBC from Paris.
And front page news, Prince Andrew could be hit with a second sex assault lawsuit. This would be a case, allegations from Joanna Schoberg. Meanwhile, David Boies is the lawyer acting for the first young woman, Virginia Giuffre.
Prince Andrew is going to have to now speak. He can't ignore court process. He can ignore me, he can ignore my client, he can ignore other victims, but he can't ignore the court.
Nick Ferrari at breakfast on LBC. Call 0345 606093.
Windrush legacy, or simply taking care of business as regards law and order? Your views. Who's first? Tony, you'll be up here in a moment. Quickly, the coronavirus figures. The percentage of UK adults to have the first dose is at 89%. Second dose is at 75%. Both bang on, it would appear. The number of new infections yesterday down a touch, 23,510. A year ago, that figure stood at 1,470. Deaths yesterday was a high figure within 28 days. I remind you, of course, that in some instances, these poor individuals will have died with other reasons, other causes. It's at 146 a year ago. That figure stood at 13. And, of course, irrespective of that, condolences to you all if your lives have been touched by that. Front pages of the newspapers, a lot of them then continuing to look at the A-levels and whether or not they're actually fit for purpose. And we are going to be covering that, I assure you, later in the hour. The Daily Telegraph summing it all up. A-level grades could be scrapped to end top marks free for all. Similar theme for the Times. Call for urgent A-levels overhaul as grades soar. Similar for the I as well. Reveal plan to fix A-level inflation. But, of course, it's important to make sure that next year's sixth formers, so the lower six, as it was called in my day, don't sort of get a sudden shock. That would seem to be a little bit unfair. The Mail and The Guardian have the same line, which is the gap between pupils at schools. Fury over grade gap. State pupils fall behind 70% of private school results at A or A star. Guardian, the same theme. Gap widens between private and state schools. Front page of the Daily Express, a story we're going to look at later in the show. Super scans give hope in dementia battle. This is a high-tech test that can, it says, spot the disease in just one day. More on that, as I say, in a moment. Good show business story for the front page of The Sun, which, of course, it's what it's put on earth to do in some ways, some powerful showbiz stories. Strictly hit by jitterbug. That's a clever headline. This is one of the dancers. Oh, dear. Well, I can do the first name. Nadia Bychova. Anyway, unfortunately, she's tested positive for COVID. I'm sure the young woman will be all right. She's obviously fit, and we wish her a speedy recovery, but that means that their show could be delayed. And lastly, both the Daily Mirror and the Metro have the same front page story. Andrew Mayfay's second lawsuit is the Mirror, and rather snappy one from the Metro. Enough to make a Duke sweat, as they put it. Andrew in hiding. More details on that as well later in the hour. Tony, excuse me, I do apologise. Tony in Ealing, they're saying this is almost akin to Windrush. Do you agree? Good morning.
Listen, good morning.
Hello, sir.
First time speaking to you. I listen to you every morning, but actually first time speaking to you.
Thank you so much.
But listen, the way I see this situation,
yes,
is all races commit all atrocities, and all races have put in to rebuilding London, England. Why is it only Jamaicans being targeted and sent back? I understand some of them deserve to go back, but yes, not all of them deserve to go back. Like one crime, two crimes, like many mistakes, like the lady said in the beginning. Why is it only Jamaican flights going back?
But respectfully, it's not, sir. 18 Eastern Europeans were deported last month to countries such as Romania and Bulgaria. So it's not exclusively... I would absolutely... If the only nationality being deported were, for the purpose of argument, Jamaicans, I would absolutely support what you say.
So why is it only the Jamaicans being publicised in this way? It's giving us a bad name. You don't hear, oh, the Polish plane went, or the Indian plane went, or the Chinese. All you hear is the Jamaican plane went.
Well, can I put it to you?
Do you understand?
I do, but can I put it to you that that is part of the Windrush aspect and the appalling way that legitimate people came here to help this country rebuild, and that is still in the back, the memories of politicians and campaigners and indeed the media. So that what make, and this is just a journalistic expression,
but I think
that's what makes
using
the hook. That's what makes the hook,
Understandable, but I honestly think they're using the Windrush thing because there's so many claims going on. They're using this Windrush thing to say, you know, these people that came over to build the thing are all criminals.
Well, they're not.
They all want compensation, but we're sending them home. Let's find a way to send them home.
Well,
it's not right.
Well, it's not right that it's linked to Windrush. I do point out again, and the reason that the deportation of Eastern Europeans, and I don't know which country, indeed it may have been a variety of countries last month, is that it doesn't have the Windrush aspect, but I don't see this as effectively a new Windrush. Tony, thank you. First time, a first class as well. Look forward to speaking to you again. You look after yourself, sir. And thank you for that. 25 minutes after seven. We go elsewhere in the world. We go to the Pyrenees for a very grim discovery. LBC's France correspondent Peter Allen joins me from Paris. Peter.
Good morning, Nick. Hugely tragic story, and one which French prosecutors, supported by forensics officers, continue to investigate. Esther Dingley, a 37-year-old Oxford University graduate, went missing while on a solo hike through the French and Spanish Pyrenees last November. Her last message was to her boyfriend and Colgate, but she hadn't been heard of for more than 8 months. There was a macabre discovery of a skull bone belonging to Esther a couple of weeks ago. And on Monday, Dan Colgate discovered the rest of Esther's body and some of the equipment she'd been using. I can tell you that police search teams supported by drones are still up in the mountains trying to find more evidence to try and establish exactly how Esther came to die. The thought of a tragic accident is still being prioritised by prosecutors, but they haven't ruled out foul play.
Thanks for that, Peter. As you say, very grim story and a grim discovery. Peter Allen reporting from Paris. Back to the UK at 7:27. And Health Secretary Sajid Javid says he's already put in place plans to give the most vulnerable groups a third booster COVID jab as early as next month, possibly. My goodness me. But the head of the Oxford vaccine group said doses need to go where they can have the greatest impact. That would be, in many instances, to help those unvaccinated overseas. UK itself currently has no reason to panic, says Professor Sir Andrew Pollard. Let's put that to Helen Bedford, who's Professor of Child Health at University College London, specialising in this field, joins me now. OK, Professor, bluntly, who's right, the Health Secretary or Professor Sir Andrew? Good morning.
Good morning. I think it's a very important issue that we need to discuss. And this is because there are two main reasons why we should think about giving vaccine to other countries. One is just because ethically it's a good thing, as the World Health Organization says, nobody is safe in this pandemic until we're all safe.
Right.
And some countries have had, you know, very little vaccination. So 1-2% may be vaccinated, including healthcare workers. So, you know, from an ethical point of view, we should be sharing our vaccine. I agree with Andrew Pollard. But the other reason is that this could affect us ultimately, because as long as you have the infection circulating somewhere in the world, and it clearly is, there's the possibility of the development of variants, which we've heard about. We may get different new variants, which the vaccine is not effective against. So, you know, there are really good reasons for his suggestion about sharing the vaccine more widely.
Let me ask you this as an expert, Professor. My understanding is currently we're vaccinating down to the age in the United Kingdom of 16. Please correct me if I'm wrong. Would you seek to go lower than 16?
Well, at the moment, young people aged between 12 and 16 with serious health conditions can get the vaccine.
Sorry, generally, I didn't put that.
Generally,
very, yeah.
I think personally that this will happen in time, but I don't think it's an urgent thing for us to be doing yet. I think we need to have greater assurance about the safety of giving the vaccine to younger children.
What's your worry? I'm sorry to talk over you. I do apologise, but what's your worry?
The worry is that, you know, it is being used around the world. There have been trials, but the trial in America of the particular vaccine we're using in young people was only 3,000, which is very small. And if you're thinking about rare, serious side effects, you want to be assured that those are not going to appear, because it might damage not just the COVID vaccine program, but it could actually have an impact on the whole childhood vaccination program. So you really have to be very cautious. And I think it's a sensible approach that this country is taking.
Lastly, an old bloke like me, will I need a third dose? Will I, like a flu jab in years to come, do you think, have a COVID jab, Professor?
I think we're learning all the time, but I think this disease, we're never going to get rid of this disease completely because of the nature of the virus.
Right.
I think it's going to become something we'll have to, as they say, learn to live with, which might mean we have to have annual boosters, but, you know.
Who knows yet? That is a way forward. Okay, grateful for your time. Thank you, Helen. Helen Bedford, you're Professor of Child Health at the University College London. You specialise in the area of vaccinations. Right, more of your views coming in concerning that deportation flight. It did go ahead at 1 o'clock this morning, but roughly two-thirds of the supposed criminals had been, or not supposed, they were convicted criminals, had been offloaded. Was that the right decision? We'll look at that. Coming up after the news, the man with a shot like a thunderbolt.
Messi.
What a goal in soccer. Lionel Messi moves to Paris Saint-Germain for just under £1 million a week. He'll be trousering. Great work if you can get it. And shooting across the skies. Well, I'm told it's the red arrows, but how on earth do I know why the red arrows are going green? Yes, you did hear that correctly. Stay tuned.
Nick Ferrari at breakfast. Call 0345-6060-973.
7:35. Malcolm will be talking deportations with you in a moment, but let's ourselves move to the world of finance and business, bring into the conversation from Aquis Exchange, David Buick, who joins me now. And I'm rather pleased to see that someone's getting angry with the banking sector for closing some of the branches. David, good morning.
Good morning to you, Nick. Yep, no higher person than the Chancellor of the Exchequer.
Quite right, too.
And he is very irritated by the fact that 4,200 branches have now shut since 2015, okay, with 801 closing since the lockdown restrictions were enforced in March of last year. And the Financial Conduct Authority is considering rules to stop banks shutting these high street branches. cash is may not be king anymore, but it's still very important.
Yeah.
And, you know, access, particularly for older people and the rest of it have been used to it, is very, very important. The only thing I will say is that we must remember that fintech is now playing an enormous role in the months and years to come. We've got these companies like Revolut, Wise. You're all going to be able to make payments. You're all going to be able to get cash. And it may not be quite as desperate as it's made out to be, but I think it's absolutely right that the Chancellor and the Treasury say, come on, folks, enough's enough. You've got to cut costs, but you're there to provide a service.
Well, if you live in a town or a village where there's a market, at the end of the day, that's where those men and women go to put their cash. Quite rightly, they don't want to sleep with it under the mattress.
No.
They want to put it in the bank.
No. I mean, I'm familiar with Burnham in Norfolk, and they closed. Barclays was only there open 2 days a week.
Oh, no, it's not.
And then they just closed it all together. So people got to drive miles.
Good luck. That's good news. We also got good news in the hotel sector with IHG International Hotel Group.
Better. Okay. Not absolutely super, because, as you can imagine, they've been absolutely savaged on a global basis. There's no question or any doubt about it on this. The occupancy rates were down 21% for the same period of 2 years ago. That's the important thing. And it's taking time. Trade in Europe, the Middle East and Asia remains the worst affected. But the very positive thing that they have seen is the Holiday Inn Express brand saw the greatest increase in gross revenues, growing by about 700 million in the last 6 months to 2.7 billion.
That's sort of budget brand, isn't it?
That's right.
Yeah,
and
okay.
I think that's where people are. Even as demand started to improve in May and June, IHG's total occupancy rate, as I say, was 21% down in the comparable period 2 years ago, were par for most of these big hotels is about 40.
Okay, shall we move to Deliveroo?
Yeah, Deliveroo, I think these figures for the first half of the year are exceptionally good. The number of orders, 148.8 million orders in the last 6 months. That's double last year, which was 74.5. The revenue was 922 million for the half year. That's a pre-tax profit of 263. Margins of 7.8%. This is the interesting thing, is that it's much more international than I thought. The total transaction value, that's what all the meals were worth, was 3.385 billion. Whereas that was 1.773 billion from the UK and 1.812 billion for international business. They've got a service in the Netherlands, France, Belgium, Italy, Ireland, Spain, Australia, Hong Kong, Singapore, UAE and Kuwait. So it's growing all the time. Shares were issued in the market on the 31st of March at 390p. They fell by 30% within the first week. They're now back to 367.58p, so they're getting there.
And just before I let you go, you send a briefing note over. I love the one you've tagged at the bottom here. Where is the least affordable city in the United Kingdom to buy a home, David Buick?
Winchester.
Yeah.
That was absolutely extraordinary.
I know. I couldn't believe it. No one explained the reason. It's fantastic.
Well, over the past year, the Halifax reckons that house prices have gone up about 10.3%. The average city house price has increased generally to £287,400, which is extraordinary. But it's just apparently that it is the most beautiful place to live and the countryside around there towards the New Forest and the rest of it. And it's attracted an awful lot of people who've been coming out of urban dwellings during the course of the last year. Winchester is first. Oxford is second. Truro down in Cornwall third. Bath is equal third. And then you get to Cambridge is sixth. And London is eighth, which I find absolutely staggering at 564,000. You'd have thought it was way above, but no way. And the cheapest place to live is Londonderry in Northern Ireland and Galle.
Thanks for that, David. Running us through the league table there, David Buick.
LBC Business Update.
With Direct Line Landlord Insurance. Insure up to 15 properties on one policy.
The flight took off to Jamaica with roughly 50 foreign criminals due to be on board. Around two-thirds were offloaded. This is what you're saying. Coming to you, Malcolm, for the calls. Dennis says, let those taken off the flight move next door to those who wanted to stop them going. That's Dennis, thank you. Danny in Mercy Island in Essex. How can this be affected by Windrush? By default, they're now British citizens if related to a Windrush immigrant. This is a vexatious and frivolous challenge to buy time for their clients. Malcolm in Highgate, where are you on this, Malcolm? Good morning.
Oh, hi, Nick. How are you?
Hello, sir. Good, thank you.
Excellent. I think it's just having clear guidelines. For example, with Brexit, everyone that was European was given a chance to become permanent or not. The issue is that if these guys suddenly start to play for England, like Raheem Sterling, they'll be heroes. We just need to level the playing field. Are they British or not? If they're British, then they should be treated like any other British person. Otherwise, you have a two-tier system where you're British if you're great, and if you're not, you're not British. It's just level playing
field. But it applies to all people born overseas, Malcolm.
But if they're saying Windrush, that implies that the Windrush, they were not British when they came over.
Sorry, these aren't necessarily Windrush. Well, I don't. Well, we don't know. I can't speak for all of them, but many of them have no connection whatsoever with Windrush. They were born. They were born in Jamaica. They've come here. They've committed a crime at a fairly serious level to get that prison term, and then they are open to deportation. And I mean, I see the argument if they came here at the age of four, whatever. But I still think if you commit that level of crime, you've got to go.
I think it's. I see your point. It's, are you British or are you not? Are you British or are you not? Because Raheem Sterling was born overseas also, but
was he? Okay.
Because he played football. Because he can make money, he was basically made British. Some people didn't have his opportunity or his privilege.
Was he not born in the United Kingdom, Mr. Sterling?
No, he wasn't. He came at seven. It's just that he played for QPR, so he was probably fast-tracked. But
I see. Okay. It's just, I mean, I think where you're... If it was only Jamaicans, it would be wrong. But as I said earlier, yeah. I don't know whereabouts in Eastern Europe. I'm going to say Romania and Bulgaria. I've just made it. But they deported 18 Eastern Europeans last month. So, you know, it is on all people, effectively.
It's because they're throwing that Windrush tag out there. My grandparents came over. They came over as British citizens. They didn't come over as...
Right. Okay. Malcolm, thank you for your input, and thanks for hanging on the line. Have yourself a safe day. I think we're on the same page to a degree. Shall we move to the world of sport? Well, and news and money at Fun Camp Stadium. Do you remember the famous story? When George Best went to sign for Manchester United however many decades ago, apparently a mate drove him to Old Trafford in a borrowed Ford Anglia, right? And he was arguably one of the greatest players of his generation. Lionel Messi arrives in Paris on board his own private aircraft, where he signed a deal for around £1 million a week, and he'll be staying in the Le Royal Monceau, a hotel where his apartment costs £17,000 a night. Well, he's got to be a good player, hasn't he?
Messi collects! Messi scores! The boy is back in town!
Messi...
Dans la surface, Lionel Messi, la frappe peut-être, et le 3-0 pour Barcelone.
There he is again. That's astonishing. It's absolutely world class.
I was a bit nervous there. I thought we were going to hear all the goals. But listen to this. Listen to this for this particular player, OK? He played 778 games for Barcelona. The team he joined, the club he joined, as a 13-year-old. He scored 672 times. And it's not quite a goal a game, but my God, it's not far off. To Kieran Maguire, who's written Price of Football and is the football finance lecturer at the University of Liverpool. OK, come on, can you explain this on financial terms? Virtually £1 million a week, Kieran. Good morning.
Good morning, Nick. PSG can afford it. They are backed by Qatar. They put 150,000 Messi shirts on sale at 10 o'clock last night on their website.
Go on.
And they'd sold them within 7 minutes. So Lionel Messi delivers trophies. He delivers interest. And if anybody's been privileged enough to see him, the man is an artist. So from a financial point of view, it's actually a steal. Because if you take a look at the club from which he's come, Barcelona, they've signed three players for over £100 million each, and all of whom have failed. So I think Messi is the closest thing to a guarantee you can get in football. And he's not cost them a transfer fee, so therefore the money's gone under the wages instead.
And explain to my listeners who are a little puzzled. 2 or 3 days ago, they saw Mr. Messi genuinely crying. It wasn't fake for a moment. He's obviously heartbroken. Why did he have to leave Barcelona?
Well, Barcelona as a business has been run appallingly badly in recent years. It's spent money which it didn't really have. And under the Spanish football rules, there's a form of salary cap which clubs have to observe. And Barcelona, partly due to the pandemic, but partly due to their inability to run themselves on a break-even basis, are estimated to make losses this season of around about £500 million. And that simply meant that they couldn't afford to pay Messi.
And lastly, wishing him nothing but a successful career, unless he's facing Leicester City in the European Cup final one night, which is perhaps a little ways off. Teams take insurance. God forbid this man was to break his leg in his first game for PSG. Can they take insurance on a player like this?
You can take insurance, but the premiums tend to be very high. So most clubs effectively self-insure.
Right.
But it's possible, yes, expensive, even more so.
Always good speaking with you. Thank you, Kieran. Kieran Maguire wrote The Price of Football and is football finance lecturer at the University of Liverpool. Coming up after there's more of your views on the deportation that took place at 1 o'clock this morning. And more, we go not to Jamaica, but to the United States to hear from David Boies, the lawyer acting for Virginia Giuffre, who, of course, has brought the civil suit against the Prince Andrew.
I think it would be very ill-advised for Prince Andrew to ignore judicial process. Well, if he does, it's going to be a default judgment against him.
Downfall of the Duke of York?
Call Nick Ferrari now. 0345 6060 973. This is LBC.
Use code SUMMER to save £5 at zingflowers.com. Zing Flowers. Amazing every time.
Has your business lost at least £40,000 as a result of COVID restrictions? Do you have business interruption insurance? If the answer is yes, COVID claims could help you reclaim financial losses, even if your initial claim was refused, you've been made a low offer, or you just don't know where to start, all on a no-win, no-fee basis. Just text EXPERT to 66777 for help from COVID claims, regulated by the FCA. Text EXPERT to 66777.
Hybrid. Parks itself.
Are we there yet?
Only 23 hours, 52 minutes and 22 seconds to go, darling. Really get to know before you buy with a Ford 24-hour test drive. But hurry, the clock's ticking. Promotion runs throughout August. Ford, bring on tomorrow. Search Ford 24-hour test drive. At participating Ford dealers, test drive subject to availability.
It's time for Feel Good Fibre, because saving on BT Superfast Fibre and getting 3 months of Big Sport for just £1 a month, then £40 a month, feels a bit like... So switch to Brilliant Broadband, now only £25.99 a month. But be quick, this sale ends 26th of August. For Feel Good Fibre at a Feel Good price, why choose anyone else? Join BT today. 24-month contracts, new customers. CPI plus 3.9% increase each March. Average speeds, content may change. £73.99 from month 25. Terms apply.
So you now earn me not just one, but 1.5 membership rewards points on every pound when we spend 20k. It's fair to say you've got a bright future.
Thanks, boss. As you can see, I'm an Amex Business Gold card, so I'm just doing my job.
Not anymore. Now you're a senior executive Amex Business Gold card. You've earned it.
I won't let you down.
The all-new American Express Business Gold card. The card that works harder for your business. Search Amex Business Gold. Terms apply, 18 plus, subject to approval. Annual fee, £175, first year free. Basic card also available with no annual fee or benefits.
Make a super saving on the nappy change with Pampers Jumbo Packs of Nappies. Now half price. Cut to £5.99. Morrisons, make good things happen. Majority of stores and online subject to availability. 42 to 86 packs was £12 each, max 3 per customer. End 17th of August.
Birds chirping, lawnmowers mowing, turning on Do Not Disturb for the foreseeable future. And the Twix and Mars McFlurry from McDonald's. Available for a limited time. Make this summer a little more special. Served after 11 a.m. Available until the 24th of August 2021. Participating restaurants only, subject to availability.
Nick Ferrari at breakfast on LBC. Call 0345 6060973.
9 minutes for eight. Come back to more of your views on that deportation in a moment. But let's reflect what's on the front pages of many of the newspapers today, which are questions being asked about the A-levels. And we need to have that conversation. But can I just say, let's just celebrate for the mostly young people who got those grades yesterday. It's desperately disheartening for them. They put in some instances, probably 10 years of studies. OK, it it does seem a bit strange. The A-levels possibly are rather debased, but please don't let that be reflected on mostly the young men and women who are celebrating it. So if you've got your A's or even your B's or whatever you got, well done. The grown-ups are going to have a bit of a row now about whether the A-levels are working or not, but you did a great job, so well done. Now, I'm sure I won't row with my next guest, who is Labour MP and Shadow Education Secretary Kate Green, who has possibly got an answer. Kate, I just think it's unfair for the children. Thanks for coming on the show. Just to make that point, they slay bloody hard and they've done what they can do. Kate.
Absolutely, Nick. I'm really glad you said that. And I want to echo what you said and pass on my congratulations to all those young people to, you know, what they've achieved this year after 15 months when their education has been massively disrupted by the pandemic. I think they should be really proud of their achievements. And far from trying to suggest that they haven't really achieved or deserved these grades, we should be pointing to how much they've achieved in the most challenging of times. And I really look forward to seeing what more they're going to achieve as they continue on their learning journeys.
And two aspects that I know you and your colleagues at Labour are keen to look at. One is that possibly the A-levels do have to be retooled or reworked in some fashion. And there is quite a gap between those children who attend private schools and those who attend state schools. Your views on those two aspects, Kate?
Yes, so I am worried about some of the inequalities that existed already, haven't been created either by the pandemic or by this year's grading system, but which we've seen have been even more marked this year. So, for example, a much larger increase in A grades at A level for private schools compared with their state secondary counterparts. And also we've seen that children from disadvantaged backgrounds, black children, children on free school meals, have seen the lowest increases in grades. Now, that probably in part reflects existing educational inequalities, the fact that the pandemic did hit poorer families harder. They didn't have all the resources they needed for home learning. We think it also reflects, and evidence that we saw from the Sutton Trust earlier this week has suggested this, that the assessment methods that were used, for example, in private schools may have helped those children to achieve higher grades. And that's because there wasn't a single methodology that all schools had to apply to carry out the assessments. So I think the lesson for us from that is that working with the profession, the government needs to make sure that we really do have a system that is fair to all students and enables them all to show what they are capable of. Tweaking the grades, I don't think that is going to address some of the underlying challenges both in the education system, inequalities in the education system, and the way in which we assess students. But I think you're absolutely right to say that we need to do more to make sure that every student is treated and assessed fairly.
Many of the young men and women we're talking about, Kate Green, will be off to university, and in some instances they're going to be charged £9,000 for studies that a lot of it will be done online. Should the government be doing more about that to try and insist or try and twist the arm of vice-chancellors to get students back on campus?
Well, let's remember it was the government, of course, that told vice-chancellors that students couldn't come back to campus, should stay away in April and May when the rest of us were beginning to go back to pubs and restaurants and so on. And I think it's important to say, actually, that we know that most universities will be doing the majority of their teaching face-to-face in the coming academic year, although there will be a remote learning, which in many cases will supplement that face-to-face teaching. And that's a good thing because, you know, it enables students to go back over a lecture, perhaps watch it again at a time that really works for them, to take in parts that they haven't understood properly the first time. So I don't think we should assume that all remote learning is second rate. You know, it's a very good element of the way in which students study. But obviously there are some courses where face-to-face is particularly important, practical courses, medicine, dentistry and so on, and they must be a priority for face-to-face teaching. You're right to highlight the support that the government could and should be giving to universities and to students. Last year, of course, they really didn't get the normal university experience, did they? Both socially as well as academically. In all cases, in all of the nations of the UK, governments did put up money, hardship monies, to support students in those circumstances. But I have to say that the hardship fund that the Westminster government put up for students in England was much, much less generous than Labour's government in Wales. And that has left students, I think, feeling that they haven't necessarily all been treated fairly.
Would you and your party support a cut in fees, Kate Green?
Well, I think what we've got to look at now is a system that doesn't deter students from participating in higher education when it's right for them and they can make the most of it and you know, it's the right choice for them. And there is evidence, I think, now that the level of student fees is becoming more of a deterrent. The level of debt is becoming more of a deterrent to some students. I think we also have to acknowledge that those student debts are very often not repaid either in part or often at all. And so the financial model is no longer looking robust in the way that perhaps it did when those loans were first brought in. But I do think it's really important to understand that that if we were to look at a different level of fee structures, that we need to think about the whole question of how we fund our university sector properly.
All right. Kate, before, just a couple of other questions. A politician that you shadow, Gavin Williamson, yesterday wrote an article in which he said he'll never forget the day that he got his A-level results. But when I asked him his grades, for some obscure reason, he refused to. Kate, you're far younger than I, but do you recall the grades that you got, Kate Green?
Yeah, so I went to school in Scotland, Nick, so it's a bit of a complicated story. I've got hires, and I've got two things that were called certificates of six-year studies as well. Now, I think I remember this correctly, and if I'm wrong, you know, I'm not absolutely saying that I'm, I'm deliberately trying to mislead your listeners. I think from memory, I got four A's and two B's at higher and two A's at six-year studies. And I just want Gavin Williamson to know, Nick, if I may say this, that one of my A's was for Latin.
Well done. I like that. Just lastly, as a senior representative of the opposition, there has been some opposition to the deportation flight that took off at 1 a.m. Should that have gone ahead, in your view?
I think it's really important that the rule of law is respected. It's really important that the dignity of everybody on these flights is respected, and often that has not been the case. And I think if there's any doubt at all that there is a question mark over these deportations being lawful and all process having been properly carried out, that must be fully reviewed and investigated. If anyone in any circumstances, not just in the case of this flight, is to be deported, we must know that the decision-making is absolutely robust.
Jeremy Corbyn said the flight was inhumane, Kate.
Well, I've heard reports of some pretty horrible treatment, actually, of people who were going onto these flights, not being able to go to the toilet before they board the plane, being kept in cramped conditions, sometimes being shackled or handcuffed, when it doesn't seem to me, from the reports I've heard of some of these flights, to be necessary. I think if we can't treat people with kindness, compassion and dignity, even if we're enforcing immigration laws and that they will be very unhappy about, then we are failing as a country.
Thanks for your time. Congratulations on your success just those few years ago when you got your hires. That's Kate Green, who is the Shadow Education Secretary and Labour MP. Talking about deportations, let's pick up on that with Chris in Richmond. Just under a minute. Chris, go ahead, sir. Good morning.
Good morning. Well, there's a piece in The Guardian the other day saying that there was someone who'd been in this country since the age of two. That person is now going to leave behind a two-year-old and an unwell mother. Well, how does our society benefit from
that? What crime did he or she...
A drugs offence. We don't know what the details are, but the reality is that child won't not care. The mother won't have anyone to look after them. Why don't we spend money on rehabilitating people? I understand people come as adults, they murder someone that's slightly different. But someone that came age two...
I would suggest that he's got, I'm assuming it's a he, quite a lengthy track record of drug dealing.
2 years. 2 years. He only got 2 years, Nick, so it clearly can't have been that serious. Why isn't this government focused more on the criminal justice system, which is falling apart, as you and I well know?
Chris, you came in exactly where I need you, as ever. Good to hear from you. Best wishes to your family. Thank you. This conversation will continue. We will try and get back to this if we can. But coming up immediately after the show, the true story. They're thinking of turning the red arrows green as Boris Johnson's blue army sees red over his green measures. Yes, there's a lot of colours, and I'll do all fill in the colouring book right after the news. Plus, Andy Byford, the man who runs TFL, is coming in late in the show. He spoke to me in March last year.
People do need to have confidence that transport is safe. I think in the early days, the messaging, which rather unhelpfully said avoid public transport, that gave people the impression that it was unsafe.
And in other news, a second woman comes forward to make allegations of inappropriate sexual action to the Duke of York. Those stories are more after the 8 o'clock news on LBC.
This is LBC from Global. Leading Britain's conversation with Nick Ferrari at breakfast.
Morning, 4 minutes after eight on Wednesday, August the 11th. Coming up in this hour, the Red Wall Revolt for the Blue Army of Conservatives and why the red arrows could be turned green. I'll colour in all the shades of conversation on that one. Meanwhile, in other news, another woman comes forward to say that as a teenager, she claims she was sexually abused by Prince Andrew.
I didn't sweat at the time because I had suffered what I would describe as an overdose of adrenaline in the Falklands War when I was shot at.
I suggest, with all due respect, you might be sweating now, sir. In other news, and later in the show, our church wedding's on the way out. Religious ceremonies fall to a record low. That might be a record low, but try this on for a high. 21 prison officers in England and Wales are being assaulted each day, a rise over the last 10 years in violence on these officers of 247%. A 247% lift. More on that later in the hour.
Nick Ferrari at breakfast. Call 0345 6060 973. Text 84850. Nick Ferrari at breakfast on LBC.
All of us want cleaner air. There's no question about it. Whether you have children, whether you have grandchildren, whether just for yourself, you want cleaner air. And you don't want to continually turn on your radio, open your newspapers or switch on the TV news and see vast parts of the world on fire, whether it be Turkey, whether it be California, Australia, Greece, or indeed other issues such as would appear Venice starting to flood. None of it, or terrible storms. And it is now. The link is there, OK? I absolutely 100% get it. Much of this is man-made. Action must be done. Carpe diem, seize the day. But at what cost politically, and at what cost for you? I say this as Boris Johnson has a warning from his Conservative colleagues north of the so-called Red Wall, and they say that this effort to go green will bring about a cost. Lincoln MP, his MP in Lincoln, Carl McCartney, says all the builders, mechanics, petrol heads and even EV lovers are rolling their eyes at this idealism. Another of his colleagues, who prefers to say unnamed, tells The Sun, of course we have to reduce emissions, but chasing after headlines without the proper consideration of the economic impact is idiocy. Quite interesting, research done again by The Sun shows that only 16% of electric car or hybrid car owners plan to vote Conservative, 69% supporting Labour, of voters who have those sides of cars. So they are starting, it would appear, they're starting to lose that particular electorate. This as another headline says that ministers will now look at downgrading plans to ban the installation of new gas boilers from 2035. The government was considering a ban on new gas boilers from that date to encourage you to buy more environmentally friendly alternatives, such as a heat pump or what's called a hydrogen boiler. But costs running between £10,000 and £12,000, it says here, which I would imagine is considerable. I mean, what's an average boiler? I haven't put a boiler in for years. What's a boiler going to cost you? I would have thought 3,000, something like that. So one of you will have put a boiler in. Last time was, God, over 10 years ago. It's about 2,000, as I recall then. But it's a lot of money to suddenly find. So is that the political reality? And in some instances, they are chasing after headlines. Greg Archer is UK director of the Transport and Environment Campaign Group. Is this a position where the politicians are playing for those powerful headlines, but it's not backed up enough? Good morning.
Good morning, Nick. Yes, I mean, I think what we're finding is that we're having to make changes in the way that we travel and in the way that we heat our homes, and we're going to have to make those changes in the future. There will be a cost to doing that, but there is also a cost of inaction. And that cost we are now seeing in London with the flooding which is happening on a routine basis, in the fires that we're seeing in Greece and so forth. So inaction also comes with a huge cost as well. What we need to do is to now find a way in which we can make it affordable for people to make the transition.
But that's the key, isn't it?
And the government is starting to do that.
But it's, if I'm a plumber in Preston, right, and I'm running around in a diesel van, the electric equivalent is very expensive. It's prohibitively expensive. It will put me out of business. Why should I have to buy it?
But you don't have to buy it today, Nick. What the government is saying is, if you buy a new van in 15 years' time, that has to be electric. And good evidence is now showing that within 5 years, the price of an electric van is going to be the same price as a diesel van. And it's going to be cheaper to run. So that plumber is going to be quids in by switching to an electric van, because he won't have those high fuel costs and it won't cost him any more to buy.
But if it's so urgent, Greg, why are we waiting another 15 years? Why aren't those initiatives to make the cost of that Ford, Toyota, Mercedes van exactly compatible now?
Well, the companies need time to scale up the production. That's what they're starting to do. Many car companies are now committing to being fully electric by 2030, others by slightly later dates than that. The car companies and the van companies recognise that the future is electric, And that's why they're switching their production across, because they know these products are going to be cheaper and they're going to be better for consumers.
How are we going to generate the massive amount of electricity that's required?
It's not a massive amount of electricity.
What, if every vehicle in the land runs off electric?
Yes, it's not. It's 20% more generation. That is all. Okay? So it's not a massive amount. And if we charge our cars at night, which is where we when we expect them to be charged, we won't be placing an enormous demand on our electricity grids.
I live on the 17th floor of a tower block in Sunderland. How am I going to charge my car at night?
Well, you'll be able to take it to the supermarket like you normally do.
It won't start.
You'll be able to plug it in and charge it there, Nick.
Where? I'm 17 floors up in Sunderland. Where am I going to plug my car in?
Charge it at the super. You'll be able to charge it at the supermarket and at the shops.
No, no. I live 2 miles from the supermarket. I want the car to go in the morning. I want it to start in the morning. Why have I got to go to Asda or Waitrose? It doesn't work. This is the reality of it, isn't it? Greg, you're a nice bloke. Mate, you're a nice bloke, but that is not. Lots of people, not everyone has access to a front drive or whatever it might be, or even a garage. They live in high-rise apartments, particularly in the cities. They're not all going to be able to have cables dangling down the outside of tyre blocks charging their cars. Right, well, how are they going to charge them?
They're going to charge them when they use their car. So there will be charging points where they park to charge them during their routine use of the car. The typical person will only need to charge their car for a 50% charge once a week. That's how much cars are used, and that's what the range of electric cars are today. They don't need to be plugged in every night now.
What about the plumber? How's he going to charge his van in Preston?
Well,
you see, it's all very good, and as I say again, you're very well, and you are trying to make the air. You're trying to make the air cleaner for my children, my grandchildren, and that. And I respect you and your colleagues for that. But there is this enormous gap between what you are quite rightly striving to do, so we all live longer, and the reality, which is my listeners, one of whom is 17 stories up in Sunderland, and the others is a plumber in Preston, and they just think this stuff is for the birds, Mr. Archer.
I appreciate that's what they think, but what I'm saying is there are 25,000 charging points in the country already. There are thousands of charging points going in across the UK every year. But the charging infrastructure is building up to the point where people will be able to make use of electric vehicles when the transit, you know, when they need to. But the point is that your plumber will not need to shift to an electric car until 2050 unless he's buying a new one. We will be able to continue to use second-hand cars and vans right out until 2050. That's another 30 years.
Yeah, I mean, a plumber is going to renew his van, I would have thought, in the next 29 years, in all honesty, Greg. I mean, that's a hell of a... I mean, I've just had a fridge that's given up after 24 years, and I've celebrated that. I mean, a van that lasts 29 years with plumbing kit on board, I doubt there are many of those around.
No, but you'll be able to buy a diesel van right up to 2030.
All right. I'm grateful, as ever, for your time, Greg. Thank you. Greg Archer is the UK Director of the Transport and Environment Campaign Group. And again, I realise, and these people are very admirable in their intentions, but it just doesn't join up, does it? And it's really perhaps not that surprising that it's the canny folk in the north who seem to be waking up to this far quicker. Because think of those. I mean, I know there are tower blocks everywhere. I understand that. There are plenty in London. I get it. But as this Northern MP says, let me just get the quote absolutely right. We have to reduce emissions, but chasing after headlines without the proper consideration of the economic impact is idiocy. Surely he's right on that. Also, talking about transport, the man who is in charge of transport for London is going to be coming in later. But say a quick call on the idea of this green initiative. Andy's in Howden, which is in East Yorkshire. Good morning, Andy.
Good morning. Just let me take you off hands-free.
Okay, sir. Go on, Andy.
Sorry about that. Your guy, Greg, that's just been on about this 20% increase in electricity supply, is complete and utter tosh.
Right.
You just sit down and do a little bit of physics. I'm an electrical engineer.
Right.
You know, sit down and calculate the power of a domestic car, you know, a normal car. You know, we're looking at 3, 4, 5 times the increase in electricity supply that we need to power all this electricity. You know, all these cars and boilers. It's just a complete fallacy.
Are you on board for this revolution? would you say, Andy?
I would like to see us. The human race needs to clean up its act. Absolutely. But all this electrification is just a complete and utter fallacy. And it will all come out in the next 10 years when we start to have rationing in power. I mean, I was talking to a colleague the other day who says that new build houses are going to have their power, their input power to the houses are reducing from 100 amps to 60 amps.
Right.
So it's a 40% decrease in the power that will be available at your consumer unit in a house, in future houses. So it's electricity rationing that's got to come, because we just can't generate the power.
Thanks for that, Andy. Quick line from Ben in Windsor on this. Ben, you have an electric car. Is it easy to charge?
It is, yeah. But, only from home. I just plug it into, a three-pin socket and then run it through a cat flap into the driveway, and I charge it every night. But, well, the car was quite expensive, but that's fine. I could afford it.
Yeah.
But, if you can't charge it at home, it's impossible. You can't live in you could not live in a flat, like you're saying.
No.
If you're a plumber or whatever, and run it.
Are you on board for this revolution?
If you're lucky enough to have a driveway, then yeah. But it's just stupid telling people that they can do it when they can't.
I know, dangling cables out of tower blocks. Grateful to you, Ben. Thank you. Safe driving to you. Talking of transport, the TfL, Transport for London Bosses, with me after this.
Nick Ferrari at breakfast. Call 0345 6060973.
21 minutes after 8, staying very much with the transport theme, and we will come back to more of your calls about the Green Revolution. But pleasure to welcome back to the studio. It's been some months. The man in charge of Transport for London, Andy Byford, he has the role of Commissioner. I need to tell you, of course, before that, he's very versed in these matters. He was President of the New York Transit Authority and Chief Executive of the Toronto Transit Commission prior to that. So he's a man who's been around the world and knows about transport. Let's bring it right back to London. Thank you for coming
in. Good morning,
Nick. And we are suitably socially distanced, or whatever one has to do. Mayor Sadiq Khan says not wearing a face mask on the tube should be a criminal offence. Andy Byford, is he right?
Well, I certainly think it would make it easier. Look, at the end of the day, we try to be customer-led. And what our customers said when the rules changed on Freedom Day, our customers said in order to keep riding on the tube, they want to have confidence that it's a safe, controlled environment. So we heard loud and clear that most people want the face mask kept. For now, we're using the conditions of carriage, but it has one big flaw. It's not backed by fines and the police can't intervene. So the mayor's right to look at options. Right now, we've got a conformance rate, of around 90%, 85-90%.
Seriously, Mr.
About that. Well, it depends. It depends. I rode the tube this morning. Surprise, surprise. I came in on the Piccadilly line. I'll be honest with you, it was less than that, but the average is around 90%. But
what was it on your tube?
I'm going to say it was probably around 75%. Now, of course, you don't know if people have exemptions and they may or may not be wearing a badge, but we do have 400 officers out there. Not that many people, but we do have 400 officers who are encouraging people to wear masks. Look, at the end of the day, we're going to keep it under review. Won't be in there forever. But that's what our customers said. They said they want the confidence of knowing that they're kept safe. So we're asking customers, please, conditions of carriage, maybe with a fine to come. Don't know. We'll wait and see. Please do that. It's the right thing to do.
How long do you think we'll be asked to wear masks on public transport?
Hard to say, Nick. I mean, we're certainly going to keep it under review. We're keeping a very close eye on what government policy looks like. We're looking at what the rates are. We're listening to Public Health England to see what their advice is. You know, I hope it won't be forever. Some people like wearing masks, other people don't like wearing masks. At the end of the day, this is about encouraging people back to use public transport with a lot of success. We're starting to see now the average ridership for TfL almost around 50%, buses around 60, tube around 40%. On the weekends, we've had the tube ridership up to 60%. So this is good. We want people back riding public transport, not a car-led recovery. So to do that, you've got to keep it safe, you've got to keep it clean, and you've got to keep it orderly.
If I seek to get on the 21A bus or whatever it might be without a mask, does the driver have to let me on?
The driver should ask you to put a mask on. I mean, obviously, they've also got to focus on the road. They should ask you to do that. They can't enforce that. They don't want to hold up the route. They don't want to hold up everyone on the bus in order, to have some sort of standoff. Our view is we can't be everywhere and police everything. We're asking Londoners, do the right thing. I myself had COVID recently. Particularly like wearing a mask, but I do because A, I don't want to infect other people, and B, I don't want to get infected.
All right. wouldn't, lastly on this, wouldn't it make it easier just to make it a criminal offence?
Well, it would certainly be easier. Here's my answer, Nick. It would certainly be easier if it was the same across the whole country. Right now, we're enforcing it via our conditions of carriage. On the mainline railways, they're asking people. There's no compulsion. It's purely voluntary. So in Scotland and Wales, however, you have to wear a mask. So it would certainly be easier if the same system applied across the country. What we have said for London, because we want people to ride transit, we have said, please continue to wear a mask for now.
Shall we talk about the congestion charge? Mm-hmm. It was initially raised from £11.50 to £15 a day. It was said to be a temporary measure. Now it's going to be forever. Why?
Well, because the reason for having a congestion charge in the first place has not gone away. We need to tackle ever-growing rates of congestion in the capital city. Something like £9.5 billion cost to the economy annually. And London has spent on average 71 hours a year in traffic jams, associated adverse impact on air quality, all those cars sitting there. So that's the reason why we do it. It's not to raise money. I'd love it if it didn't raise any money. But the money that is raised gets funded, gets put back into...
How much does it raise?
It's around £150 million a year. So that gets funded back. It
why
has
it
to be.
Why was it necessary to take it to 10 o'clock at night?
That was in a condition of the government's funding deal with TfL. But what the mayor had said was he wanted to see that pared back on the weekdays to 6 p.m. to aid London's recovery. So that's the change we're consulting on, moving it from
consult?
7...
Why didn't you just do it?
Well, I think consultation is the right thing.
Who are you consulting with?
There's an open consultation. So we're saying to Londoners, do you agree with this?
Well,
we're
have
saying,
you found anyone who
and
doesn't?
Businesses. Well, businesses love it, Nick. Businesses love the fact that where the congestion charge previously went to 10 p.m. on a weekday, now it will only be till 6 p.m. Now, that materially aids theatres, other cultural attractions in and
yes,
around
so
places
wants,
like where we are today.
Nobody wants to keep it until 10 o'clock. So why don't you go back this afternoon and just say we're going to do it?
Because I think there's statutory provisions that we have to follow, and I think it's only right that we do consult. And don't forget also, there are other changes. That's not the only change. We're bringing back the 90% residents discount, but we're also having a weekend congestion fare proposed, or a congestion charge proposed, which will be from 12 till 6 p.m. So again, that's aimed at tackling congestion. It's not about raising money, it's about tackling congestion.
Some Londoners have been revolting over what are called LTNs, low traffic neighbourhoods. What sort of conversations have you had with the emergency services?
Regular consultations, and you know, because we do hear these anecdotes where people are saying, I've seen an ambulance stuck in traffic, I've seen a fire engine stuck in traffic. On every single occasion, Nick, we go back and we talk to the emergency services and we say, are there any specific roads that you're particularly concerned about? Because obviously we don't want emergency services vehicles stuck in LTNs. So they do have keys to get through
Mr. Byford, someone's fighting for their breath, and an ambulance driver, he or she has to get a key out to get through an LTN. Are you really saying that's the way forward?
Well, at the end of the day, well, that's why we talk to the emergency services to say, if there's a route that is causing you problems, we'll take another look at it. But before we put one in, we do consult with emergency services, we do consult with local boroughs, we do a design, and we identify what the impact, any adverse impacts, and try to design those
out.
But
they can't use a key to get around a giant flower pot.
No, they can't. In that case, they couldn't, but then they would know that road has a giant flower pot, to use your example. And not to use that road. So look, at the end of the day, the LTNs are there.
You're channeling all this traffic just on a fewer roads
In some spaces we are, but here's a statistic that you might be interested in. Since the last 9 years, there's been something like a 72% increase in the amount of traffic on local roads. That is local roads where residents complain to us that they've got gridlock in their streets.
That's
they've
you've
got terrible
all the other roads.
No, this is
have
over the last
Dulwich?
9 years. And on that point, let's take Waltham Forest as an example. Waltham Forest, as an example, people say to us, it just causes traffic elsewhere. Actually, the London Borough of Waltham Forest has seen a 90% reduction overall in overall traffic.
Well,
so traffic dispersal
then.
Is not as obvious an outcome as you might think it is. On average, traffic has been reduced by around 54%. Look, at the end of the day, across the whole of London. At the end of the day, these schemes are not permanent. If there's one that's causing real problems, we can go back and have another look at it in consultation with the borough. But let's remember why they're there. And it's because there's been this exponential rise in traffic in local neighbourhoods.